All right. New setup. See how it goes. What's up, everybody? My name is Evan Naka, and we are back at the home office. Today is going to be kind of fun. I don't know why I'm still holding this. We are going to be talking about two cameras that, one, I've had, and the second one, I've been wanting to try. I've used it on other shoots, but I've never really had like a long time of just being able to handle it, use it, work with it. Sony was nice enough to actually send it to me. So thank you, Sony. I really appreciate you. Sony EDU, you're awesome. So cool. The Sony a7S III and the Sony FX III. Now the Sony a7S III, I actually own. I went and bought that with my own money. I needed to upgrade my camera. I was using a Sony a7R IV for it, and I was just like, I'm shooting too much video. I want something a lot more dedicated to video instead of my R4, which is more primarily used for photo because of the high megapixel count. So I chose the Sony a7S III because I've just been waiting for that camera. I mean, it hasn't been out for that long. I guess now it's been out for 6 months, a year? Oh, maybe like a year. But it's still really, really great camera. Now I use it on primarily all my shoots. I use it for product shoots, I use it for lifestyle shoots, I use it for events, but I use it for everything. It's got that 120 10-bit 4K capability at 60 frames, obviously 30 and 24. It shoots raw. It's an awesome camera. I have no complaints about it. But Sony did come out with another camera, which was the Sony FX III, pretty kind of recently, not really. It's been around for a little bit, but I wanted to see the difference between the two cameras because what I've heard, it's kind of the same camera. One is a little bit more geared towards cinema, and then the other one has some photo capability, not really geared for it, but it's kind of able to do both. So I reached out to Sony, they sent me the FX III. Let me just show you the cameras. We have the Sony a7S III right here. And the Sony FX III. Look at these cameras, pretty similar in size. Get some good lighting on them. You know, I'm gonna take off the cage so I can give you a little bit better of comparison. Let me take off the cage. 2 seconds. I took the cage off the Sony a7S III. Now I'm just kind of feeling eyeballing. Like I said, I've always preached this. I am not a technical shooter. I know what makes a camera good. That's kind of all I really need at this point. And it seems to be working out pretty well. So I'm gonna tell you right now, this one's a little heavier, just by a tad. I like this body style. It's really nice. It's sleek. It sets it apart from the other cameras. It has the flip monitor, just like the Sony a7S III. They both have that, which was a great function. Like, finally, Sony, thank you for giving us these screens. So like I said, I've had this camera for a while, but I want to test this camera out. So I used it on a couple different shoots. One shoot that I was using it with was with Wax Bear. It was a product slash lifestyle shoot, doing a little bit of beauty, adding product in there. We were doing a lot of portrait photography, which I was using the R4 for, but then for the actual video commercial, we used the FX III, and that's when I fell in love with that camera. This was before Sony had sent it to me. One of my DPs, he was the one that had the FX III. He used it. I was like, this is kick-ass. I love it. It is such a great, great camera. From there, I wanted to try it out myself and use it on my own shoots. So I got to use this camera 2 days ago for a shoot, and it was with Terramana. I've shot with Terramana before. They're a great, great company. They have awesome tequila. And they were doing an activation in downtown Disney with their monomobile, and they needed some event coverage. And I said, perfect, I'll be there. I got the perfect camera for it. We're gonna throw it on a gimbal. We're gonna go check it out, see how that all works. So I didn't know this going into it, but the founder of Terramana was gonna be there. And I don't know if you know anything about Terramana, but the founder of Terramana is, enter drum roll. Probably shouldn't be shaking the camera. Enter drum roll. Dwayne Johnson, DJ, The Rock. I mean, he was there. I actually got to meet him, talk to him for like a brief 10, 15 seconds, but such a cool guy, so awesome. He also ended up bringing Emily Blunt because they were promoting their new movie that's out, Jungle Cruise. Yeah, I don't know. It was just like one of those cool moments. I was like, I remember when I shot for Terramana just as a kind of like a spec shoot, not really a spec shoot. I just wanted to shoot something cool with the bottle. I like The Rock. I'm from Hawaii, so there was like this connection there. And then come full circle, I'm meeting him at Downtown Disney, and I get to work with him and his amazing team. So the settings I was using out there was 4K, 60 frames per second, shooting at 10-bit. Now, that's a lot of information going into this camera. And we were shooting in S-Log3, which is that flat profile, really helps with color grading if you really want to take it a little further in post. And we were also trying to sync it up with other cameras like the Blackmagic, just so that we had kind of a similar look and feel as we were putting the edit together. I was using the 24-70, I had it on the Ronin RS2, and I was good to go. You have your in-camera stabilization, you have the lens, which also has stabilization. I mean, you just get a smooth, buttery, just movement of the camera, and it looks just gorgeous, it looks good. So a couple of things that do set this camera apart from the Sony a7S III, from the FX3, is that the FX3 does have this vent, and it has some internal fans. If you can see that right there, that's probably a better view, right inside there, these vents. And then it has these nice kind of latches that open up, and it has all your normal ports that you would need for any type of connections, HDMI, auxiliary, mic, what have you. Now, I thought these fans would be enough when I was taking this camera out in the heat. It was probably like 90 degrees in Downtown Disney, and you know, I was shooting the 10-bit, 60 frames, 4K, lot of information going to this camera, and I did run into one issue, overheating. That was probably one of those moments I was just like, you're like, of course, you're out, you're shooting in Disney, you got The Rock there, you got Emily Blunt. You don't want any shit to happen that's gonna create it so that you can't get the shot. And what happened? It overheated and it shut off on me, and I was so, so mad. But, you know, luckily this is why you have backup cameras and you have other people on set. We all cover all the different angles. No worries, we got the shots we needed, and it still ended up being amazing. But it was one of those things that I was like, in the moment, I was like, dang, you know, I just really wish that wasn't an issue. So did a little bit of research, and I found out that there actually is something you can do for that. It's the default settings that it comes with. I'm just gonna show you really quickly what that looks like and when you wanna actually change that. So when you get your camera, you have the default settings, and a lot of us know you gotta change your image quality, picture profile, frames per second, yada yada, the list goes on. But something that you might not be aware of is the internal fan setting that you can change pretty easily. I'm gonna show you how to do it. So to change the setting is pretty simple. You're gonna go ahead and click on your menu, and you're gonna scroll down to that little basket, bucket, briefcase, whatever that thing is, and you scroll over, you go all the way down under display options right there, number 8, power setting options. You're gonna go over, you're gonna go down, and right there, see how it says standard? We don't want standard default settings. We wanna push this camera to its limits. So we're gonna put it to the high. And right there, you get a little disclaimer, hit okay, boom. That's it, that's all you gotta do. It fixes the problem. It doesn't harm the camera in any way. It's just like that little reserve that makes sure that the camera is gonna stay safe. And it's just, we wanna take the training wheels off. We wanna get that camera and use it outside in 90 degree heat. Make sure we get what The Rock is cooking. We don't wanna miss a single thing. And that's how you do it. I wish I knew that beforehand. Now you will if you ever decide to use this camera. Also, I wanna take one second, because since we're talking about video, you can't have video without lighting. And I just wanna do a huge, huge shout out to Aperture. They just sent me something and I'm just like, I can't believe they did. And I've been doing video for a long time, and I've used Aperture lights just on my own. I bought them myself. This is the first thing they've ever sent me. So I'm pumped, and I wanted to show it to you because you can't really get these right now because they're just out of stock because everybody's looking for them. I'm gonna show you what it is. It's so pretty. It is the Aperture 600D Pro. I love it. They also sent me the light on top of it, not just the battery box. I'm gonna do a dedicated video coming up here pretty soon on Aperture lighting and how I use it, how I set it up, when I use it for video, when I use it for even photo. So stay tuned for that one. All right, to finally wrap this up between these two cameras, yes, same sensor, image quality is gonna be pretty much the same. There are certain things in here that are geared more to cinematography. This is just slightly more dedicated to the in-between, but way more heavily focused on video. So who are these cameras for? I would say if you're still starting out and you only can afford one camera, but you do a lot more video than photo, but still might need that little bit of photo capabilities. Let's say you wanna create thumbnails on a shoot or something like that. You're not getting terrible photos out of this. It's just not at the level of like an R4 or anything. I would say that this is the camera for you. Now the FX3 is probably geared towards someone that's a little bit more video focused and not really considering doing any photos. It's gonna have the XLR inputs with the handle. Let me show that to you. When you get this attachment with it, you've just upgraded your camera to be able to handle more professional audio. It's easier to hook up, easier to sync. It's meant for that. All the time coding issues or anything that you might face with other DSLRs, this one helps a lot. It is a great entry level camera. And when I say entry level, I say it with a grain of salt because this is by no means an entry level camera, but in cinematography, in the cinema line of cameras and how high they go, this one is a great entryway camera that will teach you enough and then you can upgrade down the road. So that's who this camera is for. And that's it for today. Thank you so much for hanging out with me. I'm happy to get back on YouTube. I promise that I'm gonna be doing more of these in the near future. I like this setup. I think this is it. I'm pretty happy with how this is looking. If you don't like it, let me know. If you do like it, let me know. Actually, you know what? If you don't like it, don't tell me because it hurts my feelings. Anyways, I hope this little review helps you on your decision-making in terms of what kind of camera to get. If you have any questions, please leave them down below. And as always, if you liked it, like the button, subscribe. Yada yada. You know what to do already. I don't need to explain it. There's plenty more to come. And finally, I'm Evan Naka. I'll see you guys next time. Bye.